to you all. We're very happy to have you here this morning. We have a lot of visitors, and we're certainly thankful for your presence and attendance with us. We want you to come back every opportunity. We'll meet again at 6 o'clock tonight for our monthly questions and answers time. And, of course, on Wednesday at 7, we'll have our classes we regularly do, though we haven't had it very often. I've been gone a lot, but we'll have it this Wednesday for sure. And then tonight, there is, I think somebody mentioned a men's meeting after we're done. I want to add to that, while the men are meeting, there'll be a brief meeting for the ladies as well. So if you can please stay for that, ladies, tonight after services for that meeting. We had a wonderful week at the Gospel Crusade last week. Some of you just saw me last week. It feels like it's been 10 years since I was preaching here last. It was that long and that drawn out of a week, but it was a wonderful event. In Conway, we had about 500 or 600 in attendance each night, and it's a very special event for me, and I'm thankful for this congregation's support, for those who came and helped make it another great event. I want to remind us before we get started, just a couple of events. It feels like summer's starting to wind down, for me at least, though it's actually still about halfway through the season. But there are still a couple of events we need to keep on our calendars and be aware of. On, as Sonny mentioned, August the 25th, the fourth Sunday of August, it is our Friends and Family Day. It's our homecoming Sunday. And we want to have, as we had last year, an almost full house last year, I'd like to have an absolute full house. So invite everyone that you know, all of your friends and your family, your neighbors, your relatives, your worst enemies. Invite everybody that you can and have them come out and be a part of that wonderful event with us. There are some people who would never think to darken the doors of another place of worship than the place that they've gone their entire lives. I totally understand that. As someone who likes things comfortable and familiar, I get that. So make this something that's a special event. Invite them and say this is a special occasion, and that might, you might not have any other opportunity to reach them, but you might have one Sunday. If we get them to come, we might get them to come back. So invite those that you know for that. But on the day before Friends and Family Day, Saturday, August the 24th, that is our Ladies' Day. So ladies, please mark that on your calendars and invite all of your friends that you know as well from 9 a.m. to 12. We have a good theme. I think they do. I won't be here to hear it. But it's a godly life for a godly wife. And so we have three speakers who are going to be speaking to the ladies with various topics around that theme. So it's expected to be a wonderful event. So please be there to support that. There are several vacation Bible schools in our area. We had ours early in the summer. Most congregations have theirs in the mid to late part of the summer. Be aware of those. If we want them to come to ours, we need to go to theirs. So be there and support them as much as you can in our area. With that said, I'll be at Perryville tomorrow night if you'd like to come with us. We don't have a church van. Plug. We might want to get that one of these days. And if you want to carpool with us and just have a big long convoy on to Perryville, it's a little bit away, a ways tomorrow, but it is always the best vacation Bible school probably in the country, and I always look forward to it. Even if I wasn't speaking, we'd be going just to enjoy that time with our friends and Christian family. On to this morning. I originally planned on preaching this text last year. I put it aside because I had other things that came up, and I had always planned on preaching this text at some point because I always loved this psalm. My original plan for this text, Psalm 150. Open your Bibles there if you want to now. My original plan for the psalm was to teach first what it says, and then teach what it doesn't say. First teach what it teaches, and then what it doesn't teach. Well, that sermon as it was written would have been about an hour and a half long. For your convenience, it's been split. So I will just speak this morning on what this psalm teaches, the message of this psalm. On some future occasion, we'll come back and revisit this marvelous six-verse poem. A psalm of praise to God. And we'll consider ways it could be taught that is separate from the context of the study itself. This psalm teaches how to and the reasons for worshiping, or rather praising God. Now all worship is praise, but not all praise is worship. We define worship, your Bible defines worship, as an act or an offering presented to God by a priest of God, whether those be the priests who are the Levites under the old law of Moses, or all Christians under the new law of Christ. All Christians are priests today. When we offer our offerings, whether that be financial offering as we think of the word, or our song, or our prayer, or as we're studying our Bible now, those are specific acts of worship that is itself a form of praise to God. But though all worship is praise, not all praise is worship. For example, 1 Corinthians 11:2, Paul says to his brethren in Corinth, I praise you, brethren. Well, Paul's not worshiping his brethren. You find numerous examples of people who are praising each other. When I say, good job to the congregation, that's me praising you. And you say to me, good job for whatever I might do, that's you praising me, but you're not worshiping me. When we praise God in worship, that is praising God. But there are other opportunities that we have where we can praise God separate from worship. Consider that 3,000 years ago, when this psalm was written, if you tell Israel to worship God, here's what he does. He takes his animal sacrifice, he goes to the priest into the outer court of the temple, takes it to the priest kills the animal. Actually, he holds the hand of the Israelite, so they both kill the animal. Then they offer it on the altar. The Israelite who does the official worship just stands back and hopes that the priest is doing it correctly, because he is not allowed to offer the worship because he's not a priest. Only a priest can offer proper and correct worship. He has to stand on the sideline. Now, how much better is it under the new law of Christ? Where my Bible says, 1 Peter 2:9, all Christians are priests, and all of us, and right now we're all doing it, have the privilege of offering true worship in spirit and in truth to the Father. But separate from, and this is what this poem, in fact, is the last five psalms of the Psalms, 146 to 150, separate from you Israelites who have to offer your animal sacrifice and stand on the sideline, separate from that, David writes, you have opportunity, you have example, you have reason in your life to just be thankful. And so from that, the last five psalms of the Psalms are written. As we look through this text that we're going to study, Psalm 150, this is a psalm that tells us the how, the where, the when, and even the who concerning praising, being thankful for God. Now someone might say, but Christians don't live under the old law of Moses. We don't follow the rules and the laws of the Old Testament, so do we even need to know about this psalm? Absolutely, we need to know about this psalm. It's in your Bible for a reason. And you can take these words, though they're written to people 3,000 years ago, and we are here, a very different world 3,000 years later, we can still read these words, and we can find application for these words, so that we in our everyday life, as we'll apply the way the verses are written to our lives, we'll see examples when we can stop and just say, thank you to God that is offering praise, being thankful that God is on our side. So as we study this psalm, let's first notice the where concerning praise. Look at the very first verse. We're going to look at all six of these and start with just the first verse of Psalm 150. David says, praise ye the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in the firmament of His power. Here's how we're going to apply it. You praise God internally, and you praise God externally. The opening four words of the psalm set the stage for the whole poem. Praise ye the Lord. He'll repeat that at the end, and we'll get to that on our last point. But it sets the stage, and then he first tells us where you're praising God. That is to say, where is God when I'm praising Him? He is first, he says, in the sanctuary. 3,000 years ago, the Israelite who reads this poem for the first time knows just what that means. God is in His tabernacle. Sanctuary. He's in His holy place. There was a big, fat tent right in the middle of the camp. Later when they settled in Israel, there was a big gold-layered building called the temple. But whether it's the temporary tent, the tabernacle, or the permanent structure, the temple, there was a building erected for the people to look at and know within that building was a place called the Most Holy Place, where only the high priest, not just the priest, but only the high priest could enter. And he could only enter once a year on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. And he would go through that veil into the Most Holy Place, and he would stand before the Ark of the Covenant. You've seen Indiana Jones, that thing, the Ark of the Covenant. On the Ark of the Covenant is the lid of that box called the mercy seat, where there are two angels, not idols to worship, but just images to represent an angelic, that holy spiritual place. And between those two angels, with their wings spread out like this, it formed what looked like a seat, and thus it's called the mercy seat, where God's presence would be manifested and where He would sit, metaphorically speaking, and offer or be offered atonement for the people when they would offer that sin offering sacrifice every single day of atonement. And God's presence would be manifested in that tabernacle. Now all of the Israelites in the camp would gather around the outer court of the temple or the tabernacle before that. And they would watch this tent, and all they're seeing is just a building. They can't see what's going on. They saw the high priest go in, and they just wait. and they wait, and they don't know what's happening until eventually a big light shines out from the roof, and then they realize God's presence has come down. And what are the people saying? Praise ye the Lord. Why? Because he's in his sanctuary. He is in his holy place. David's not saying to the people, you go into the sanctuary and praise the Lord. They couldn't. They wouldn't have been struck dead. They're not allowed to. He says to them, God is in his sanctuary. He now dwells with the people. So be thankful for that. Praise him internally. Can I do the same thing? Absolutely. Because I, the Christian, I am now the tabernacle of God. I am, you are, if you're a Christian, as a priest, the personal embodiment of the temple or the tabernacle. God, his presence is manifested within you. Now, not literally, if you cut me open, God doesn't just fall out, but his presence is manifested in us. God is in me. 1 John 4:16. John writes, Paul writes that Christ is in me, Colossians 1:27. He also writes, the Spirit is in my inner man, Ephesians 3:16. I am the temple, 1 Corinthians 6, the tabernacle that houses God. And I can be thankful and praise God that God is with me. The Israelite of old had more, though, more reason than just that to praise God. He could also praise him not just internally, that God is there dwelling with the people, but he could also praise him externally. As the psalm continues, praise him in his sanctuary and praise him in the firmament of his powers. Old word, firmament, it basically means the space. Used here, the space between us and what is above us. In other words, be thankful that God isn't just confined to a room. David writes, be thankful that God is not just confined to a most holy place where only one of the camp could ever see that manifestation. You be thankful that God can be praised, that you can be thankful that God is everywhere. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Now, I'm a Christian. I am a tabernacle of God. God is in me, but I've never seen God. The Spirit is in me. I've never seen the Spirit. Christ is in me, but at least I haven't seen Christ, yet I know he's there. I know he's with me because I know he is, how do we say it, up there? Don't we say that of God? Well, he's not really, if you keep going in space, you're not going to run into heaven. But we like to think of it that way because we like to say God is smiling down on us. And so we say, well, he's up there. We look up to God. That's all fine. That's good imagery. But basically what he's saying is God is there for you to be thankful for. God is with you, not just internally, but his entire presence is manifested all over his entire creation. I know he's sitting on his heavenly throne. I know he is there for me to call on and seek help for. And so I can praise God. I can be thankful that God is with me internally. And every time I read my Bible and I let it dwell in my heart so that I might not sin against him, Psalm 119:11, I know God is with me and guiding me and leading me. But I can also be thankful that God is just there. Don't ever say your problems are too big for God. God is there all over your problems, all over them, hovering over them, ready to help in our time of need. So, there's a where. We have opportunity to praise God. He's internal and external. Number two, look at Psalm 150, verse 2. Here's the why concerning praising God. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Why do we praise him? Has he ever given you a reason to say thanks? Has God ever given you, individual you, something for you to be thankful for? If so, praise him. Here the psalmist says, I will praise him because he is mighty. Now he says, technically, his acts are mighty, but it takes a mighty person to do mighty acts. So be thankful that God is mighty. He is a mighty maker. Psalm 50 verse 1. The mighty God calls the earth from the rising to the going down of the sun. In other words, from day until night, until day again, be thankful that God is God and praise him because of it. He's a mighty God. Don't ever say, like I just said, this is too big for God. Don't ever say that problem is too much for God. God made it all. He wants to have it all. Put your problems on him. He's a mighty maker. He's a mighty Savior. One of my favorite texts in the whole Bible, Isaiah 63, verse 1. I speak in righteousness. God says, I'm mighty to save. We even sing that song. At least the young people sing it a lot. My God is mighty to save. Well, he is mighty to save. My God is. Is your God mighty to save? What is most important in your life that becomes your God, that becomes your idol? Can it save you? The Egyptians learned the hard way. Their gods can't save them. The God of Israel couldn't save his people. My God's a mighty Savior. My God is a mighty Avenger. 2 Thessalonians 1:7. You who are troubled, rest with us. Why, Paul? Because Christ is coming back to avenge those who know not God and who obey not the gospel of Christ. He's a mighty Avenger. I want him on my side. And because he is, I can praise God. Praise him because he's mighty. Praise him, he says in verse 2, because he is excellent. Now, I use the word excellent differently than the way the psalmist uses it. I say something is excellent, I mean outstanding. That's the best. Well, God is outstanding. God is the best. But that's not this word. This word means spacious. Praise God because he is all-encompassing. I think of this word, I think of a king, rightly so, who has a train. I don't mean a choo-choo train. I mean like you see the paintings of royalty. Maybe even like a big formal royal ceremony over in England. And you see the king and the queen has this big long robe. It's not a cape. It's a big long robe that just stretches beyond her body or his body. It's called the train. Remember the Wizard of Oz when the Cowardly Lion took the green robe and threw it around him and talked about courage? Remember the big long green train? That's the train. It's this big ornate piece of clothing. They usually had inscribed or etched into it the royal family crest, so that when you saw this magnificent piece of fabric, you knew it belonged to someone worthy, someone of royalty. It's a big, long train. Isaiah went to heaven, Isaiah chapter 6, and he said, I saw God and his train, this king, fill the whole holy place where God dwelled. His train is spacious, excellent. Is this God. And that family crest etched and woven into his train is not three lions holding a shield like in England. No, his family crest has my name written on it. It has your name written on it. If you're a Christian, your name is etched onto that holy train because you are the children of the King. He's excellent. The brightness of his glory stretches across all creation. So praise him because he's mighty. Praise him because he is excellent. Praise him because the psalmist says, he is great. Whenever God is talked about as being great, it's used in one of two ways. When you compare him to false gods, they say he's great, meaning like you use the word, greater than something else. When he just stands alone and they say great is God, it means in stature. It means, really means old, but that's not an insult. Like the redwood trees in California. It's California, right? They stretch up to the sky because they're so old. They have just continued to age and to grow and to grow. And you just look up at them and marvel at the stature of the trees. That's God. He is great in stature. And when you see him and you think, he's on my side, what else is there to say but thanks be to God and give praise that he's great above stature. But listen, just because he is so big, he's not unapproachable. Just because he is so massive, he is not intimidating. Just because he is so awe-inspiring, he is not so distant. He is great, but he calls himself to me, Father. He wants me to approach him like a child approaches his dad, as his daddy and hops on his knee and makes his request and pleads for him. That's how God says, you approach me like a father. Even though he could wipe me off from existence with a blink of his eternal eye, he says, you come to me, because I am great. You praise him because he's excellent. Praise him because he's mighty. Praise him because he's great. That's why. That's where. What about when? My favorite part of the psalm, right here in the middle. Let's start in verse 3. When should I praise God? What circumstances occur in my life that I should immediately react with, praise God? Verse 3, praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery. That's a very light, airy kind of musical instrument. And the harp. In other words, put on your Old Testament glasses, 1000 BC. Praise him when the battle begins. And praise him when the battle is over. What's a trumpet signify to the soldier of the Israelite army? Time to go fight. When you hear that, you know that means the army is charging. So I either better start charging or start running. When I hear the trumpet, my first reaction is supposed to be, praise God, we've won another one. Now, if you are the Israelite soldier and you've got faith in God, you're lying in your bunk, you know the enemy is around, you don't know when the battle's going to start, but you hear the trumpet. And you hear the trumpet, you jump up and you say, praise God, we've won another one. Then your bunkmate, who's not so faithful, says, you fool, the trumpet means you're supposed to start fighting. And you were supposed to say to him, yeah, but I'm on God's side. I'm going to fight with God. That means I've already won. When the sound of the trumpet is blared, you praise God. And then what happens when the battle's over? You praise God. when the servants or the soldiers go back to the camp, knowing they might have to fight again on that same battlefield, they call their servants to them. They play the harp to them to calm their nerves down. As you can imagine, soldiers' nerves are afraid. And as the battle is over and you've won, just like you knew you would because God was on your side, and as they're playing that harp and that psaltery, you be thankful to God that He got you through another battle. There was an occasion when the army of the Philistines stood on this hill, and the army of the Israelites stood on that hill. And there was a man of the Philistines, a soldier from Gath. You know his name? He was 9 foot 9. His name was Goliath. And he would stand, and he didn't care about fighting. Oh, if someone came his way, he'd swat him away. But his purpose was more intimidation. Goliath would get halfway down the hill. He wouldn't go to the valley where the battles were fought. He'd stay up on his hill, shouting to the other hill where his enemies were, and he would mock God, and he would insult God's people. And you know what? He had every reason to insult God's people, because as he was yelling his insults, what were the people doing? 1 Samuel 17. That's what they were doing. Terrified, because this physical presence was so big. I'm sorry, my thought on the redwoods of California, you are just 9 feet tall. But yet the people were terrified. And when the trumpet sounded, nobody went down to the battle. Nobody wanted to fight Goliath, but there was a boy, the runt of Jesse's litter, named David. And he said, I'll not only fight him, I'll beat him, and I'll show you how foolish you were for not trusting in God. Because when the trumpet sounds, I praise God. Look at 1 Samuel 17:45-47. You know this probably. You probably told it to your kids as a bedtime story. It's not a bedtime story. This really happened. There was once a little boy probably that tall who stood up to a man probably as tall as that screen. And he knocked him down. Look at 1 Samuel 17:45. As Goliath is mocking David, as Goliath is laughing at that this boy is all Israel can muster, David said to the Philistine, you come at me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield. I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel. I fight on the Lord's side, whom you have defied. This day will the Lord deliver you into my hand. Is that confidence? What's he saying? Praise God, I've won another one. And I will smite thee, and I will take your head from you. Imagine, this is a child saying this. I'm going to take your head from you. And I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines, that whole army, this day unto the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly, who's this assembly? That's the army behind him. He says, I'm going to take the host and kill them so that all this assembly, the Israelites, can know the Lord saves not with sword and spear, for the battle belongs to the Lord. Don't we sing that song? And he will give you into our hands. And so when Goliath stepped on the field, David ran. And he had 5 stones. Now listen, does that mean David didn't trust his aim? Does that mean David didn't trust God? Why didn't he just take 1 stone? Because Goliath has 4 brothers, according to 2 Chronicles. I take that to mean David was going after all of them. If another brother of Goliath steps up, well, I've got another rock. We can go again. But he sees Goliath, he takes his 1 smooth pebble and he spins it around and down goes the giant. But what did David say before the fight? God has delivered you into my hand. In other words, praise God, I've won another one. And then he went back and played a harp in Saul's ear, if I recall. Because the battle was over. The nerves had to be calmed. Praise God. When the battle begins and when the battle ends. But it doesn't stop there. Look at verse 4 of Psalm 150. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and organs. In other words, praise God when there's reason to celebrate. You've won the battle. You've gone to the battlefield. You've shed innocent blood. You've shed your soldier's blood. And yet you've won the battle. Why? Because God led you through it. Then what do? You don't stay on the battlefield. You go home. And because the people have gotten word that you've won the battle, what do they do for the soldiers as they return? They throw a ticker tape parade. They celebrate with music and dancing. Just like in Luke 15. When the prodigal son came home, the older brother heard a celebration, music and dancing, a whole symphony of sound, because they were throwing a party, which is what happens when soldiers come back. Put on your 1000 BC glasses. When the soldiers return, there's music and dancing. There's a celebration. People are playing and they're happy. Don't forget who gave you the victory. Praise God in the celebration. General Patton liked to talk about Roman conquerors. How they would go and they would invade a territory and they would conquer the people. They'd bring back their slaves. They'd bring back the spoils of victory. And as that conquering Roman general always sat in the front on his white horse. As they marched back into Rome and the people would throw flowers and they would sing their praises, the slave of that new general that he had taken would whisper in his ear, "Glory is fleeting. All glory is fleeting. Don't forget, soldier of Christ, who gives you the victory?" David didn't forget. He says, "The battle is the Lord's." But how many soldiers will go and say, "God, get me through this fight," and then when the fight is over, they think, "Look at the good I did." No, when there's time to celebrate, by all means celebrate. But remember, God gave you the victory. Praise God at the sound of battle and victory. Praise God when you're celebrating that victory. Praise God. Look at verse 5. Praise Him upon the loud cymbals. Praise Him upon the high sounding, literally in the Hebrew, alarming cymbals. In other words, you've gone back home. The party has died down. You've gone back to your bed. Everything is fine again. But then, crash. The sound of cymbals. Crash! The sound of the high-sounding cymbals. That's the sound of alarm. That's the sound that means your enemy has regrouped. Your enemy has gotten themselves together again. And they're ready to meet you on the battlefield once more. They haven't given up. And now you've got to get up. You've got to go back to the fight. And you've got to do it all over again. When that happens, it's not over. You have to say, "Oh, praise God, we're going to win another one again." And then you head out to the battlefield. What's the application? You're not going to slay your demon and then just lie down and quit. You're not going to defeat the devil and him just give up on you. My Bible says resist. It's a passive, but it's an active word. Continuously do it. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Well, once I let my guard down, the devil comes right back. You can't just slay your dragon and it stay dead. The cymbals will crash again. The alarm will sound again and your problems will persist. And when your problems persist, praise God. Don't say, "Oh no, another problem." That's what the Israelites did as they wandered in the wilderness. And they met challenge after challenge after challenge. And what happened? They started to get a little more bitter, a little more resentful, a little more angry that they kept not just having an easy day. And eventually turned against God completely and died in the wilderness. Listen, don't look at your problems as never ending. Look at God as ever reliable. So that whatever comes your way, no matter how many times you stomp it down and it keeps roaring back up, you just trust in God. And whenever your enemy comes back and you hear that alarming cymbal, time to fight again, you praise God. He'll get you through another one. We have seen the where we praise. We have seen the why of our praise. We've seen the when of our praise, internally, externally. Because He's mighty, excellent, and great. Praise Him when you're fighting. Praise Him when you win. Praise Him when you're celebrating. Praise Him when you're fighting again. Finally, let's look at the who, and then we're done. Last verse of the Psalm, 150 verse 6. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. In other words, let all the people, let everybody, the whole crown jewel of His creation, let them give praise to Him. Has He done something good for everybody? Yes. Then everybody ought to be thankful to Him. Absolutely. Is everybody thankful? Does everybody praise? Paul says every knee should bow, Philippians 2:10. Not every knee is going to on this earth. Paul says every tongue should confess the name that is greater than all names, Philippians 2:9. But not every tongue will make that good confession on this earth. But they will see God at judgment day, but on this earth, not every tongue will praise. But whether they do or they do not, look at what the psalmist says in the last four words of the verse. Whether they praise God or not, you praise the Lord. You show them your gratitude. Praise Him at all times, in all places, in every possible way. Give thanks to God, for He is a God worthy of praise. Isn't that a song we sing? Worthy of praise is Christ the Redeemer. And that's how we turn to our invitation. Are you a Christian this morning? Worthy of praise is Christ who died to redeem you. But He died for nothing if you don't obey the gospel. He died for you. He wasn't thinking of humanity, this mass of people, and just faces in a crowd like a Where's Waldo book. No, He was looking at you, your face. He was thinking of you, your name. Now, if you don't obey the gospel, if you do not reenact the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, Romans chapter 6, by being baptized into Christ, He died for you for nothing. So be thankful that Christ died for you. Then do something about it. Obey the gospel. If you're a child of God, but you have been struggling with anything. You put down a demon and it's roared right back up. Praise God. But if you need help, your family in Christ wants to help you. Whatever we need to do or say, you have to let us know so we can help you. Let us know right now, and we'll help you as we stand and as we sing.